Would you stand and honor Martin and Ellie back to the stage?
Thank you. Thank you. You did look really good in that video, actually.
Oh, thank you.
You look very, very handsome, don't you think? Very
thank
sharp.
Thank you.
Anyway.
I appreciate that. Martin Smith just said I was cool, so that's awesome. So anyway, hey, well, we just found out that you were going to be here about 4 days ago. Yeah. And we were trying to put this together two or three months ago. And when it fell through, you can ask my wife, I moped around the house for like 2 or 3 days. I was just so upset. And so she just challenged me. She said, well, why don't you just pray? So I said, God, I pray that this all works out. Martin comes in August, and I pray that it's on a Sunday morning. So all that to say, man, I just feel like there's a yeah, come on.
Yeah.
So good.
And there are some sort of trips and tours that you organize, and everything goes really smoothly. This one has been a disaster. We flew into America. As I landed, that two things got canceled. But then I found out that we were coming here. And actually being here this morning was the reason why we came. Yeah. So it's just worked out so good. Yeah.
You said it better than Thank me, you. Really. I feel like you guys are both carrying a message for today, for this house. And I know it's only your second time here, but we feel, especially as a staff, like, there's a major connection with you guys. We feel connected throughout so many years. Martin, your music changed my life. And I was just talking to Johanna yesterday, and I said, man, I don't know. I mean, God does what he does, but you put a seed in my heart to lead worship, to live a presence-driven life when I was a young kid. Actually, I didn't share this in the first service, but I remember seeing you on the King of Fools tour. And you came to a church that was 10 minutes down the road from us, Christ Community, amazing church. Anybody from Christ Community? We won't tell them that you snuck over here this morning. And I was wearing a Yankees baseball cap in the front row, and you came out and you had this big King of Fools hat on, and you did the song King of Fools, and you took my Yankees hat on, and you put it on your head, and you put the mop top crazy King of Fools hat on my head. I'll never forget that moment.
No
I think
way.
I was like 11 years old or something
you.
Like that. That was me. So, yeah. You remember. So I considered
you.
It like a mantle, like an impartation, like just rested on my head. But
crazy.
I don't know. So all that to say, and then, you know, you talked about my mom. The first time we heard that song, Did You Feel the Mountains Tremble? We covered it. And I remember my mom in her 30s, now she's in her 40s, just opened every door to the church when we were down on 13th Street on this little casket factory, just saying, you know, everyone come. And I remember Brian bringing the first Cutting Edge album over after he was on a mission trip, flying through Heathrow, and your music changed our church. And we were experiencing a massive move of God in the 90s, where this house has always been a presence-driven house and a house that values worship. And your music created the language of what we were experiencing and what we were encountering. So, you know, all that to say, not to talk about the past too much, but would you maybe just talk a little bit about your start in writing music, writing songs, maybe how Delirious, you know, formed? We'll just start there.
Yeah, it was 1992, and we were all in a church together that met in a school, small school hall, 300 people on the south coast of England. My wife's dad was the pastor. So we were kind of all involved in that. And we had this idea to start a youth meeting every month on a Sunday night, and we called that Cutting Edge. And basically it was in a small room, we turned the lights down, we cranked the music up, and we just worshiped like crazy. We gave the gospel, we saw kids come to Christ. Really simple format, because we didn't have any money, we didn't have any gear, we didn't have a screen, we had nothing. You remember the old overhead projectors? Do you remember those? And you had to put the words on there. That was us. And we thought we were really cool because we inverted, like, did the black thing on the white.
Oh, that's
do you remember
cool.
that? Anyway.
So cool.
No, I'm losing you. and so God did some miracles in that time, and it just sort of grew and grew and grew. And the songs weren't necessarily written like, oh, great, we need a new record and we need four more songs. They just organically came because every month we had this event coming up and we just decided, okay, we need to write a new song for that event. What should we sing about? Oh, I think we got a feeling we should sing about moving mountains or the trembling or, you know, hey, there's all these kids coming. I think you can all be history makers. And so it wasn't like there was no label involved or an A&R guy, or it was just us on our own. It was great.
And then the music went everywhere, all over the globe. And we talked about this. Well, you know what? I'll just pause here. What's your favorite Delirious song? Your favorite one?
I think it's a song called Obsession, because it really sort of suits my personality. It's neither a church song or worship song or a sort of mainstream song. It sort of sits in that middle space. It's mysterious. It's, I don't know kind of what is it, but it's got that sort of thing, whatever that is. You know, you just, you know, you want your heart's going to rip open. Yeah. But it's particularly special because I wrote it whilst I was in hospital. I'd had a car crash and nearly died in this car crash. My wife, Anna, was in there. This is before you were born. And so we were very lucky to get out of that car. And as I was in hospital and a broken leg and whatever, I wrote that song there.
It's awesome. Really, in the middle of Delirious and everything that was going on, songs going all over the world, your influence growing, you had a lot of kids. How many kids?
Two boys and four girls.
Wow.
And Ellie, this is where I need to hand over to Ellie, really, because yeah, she's going to dish the dirt. But yeah, if you met my wife, Anna, it would all make sense. She's just, she's a great mum in the natural, like she just loves kids. She's always wanted a big family. She's an extrovert, I'm a bit introverted. But our house is like a hotel. And I was saying in the earlier meeting, have you ever like bought like 25 pizzas and you think it's gonna last like 3 weeks? And then you have all these kids, but then you don't realize they're going to bring all their friends over. And then the whole youth group comes over, and then all my band come over, and then they're gone the next day. And so you have to buy another 25. So that's the story of our life, really. But she's not just a great mum, sort of. She's supernaturally sort of got a gift upon her life to look after people that fall off the edges. A little bit. She sort of has an amazing gift of scooping people up. So I'll come home and she's always got someone around the kitchen table and she's helping them, which is beautiful. Yeah.
And in Delirious, there were about four other families involved. Yeah. So how many, if you went out on tour with all of your kids, how many kids were on tour at the same time?
Okay, five families, which was 10 adults, 16 children. And we had our six, and Tim and Becca had four, and then it was mad. I mean, when I look back, like, we really need to go into serious counselling, because there was some trauma, but kind of a holy trauma. It was just beautiful. Can you imagine us turning up at Heathrow Airport, flying out, like, and there's like 35 of us on a plane, including our crew. And it was mayhem, but it was amazing. It really marked our own children in a way that they're now only now discovering, really, like, oh, that just really marked me as a kid, and good and bad as well. But it was a great season.
Well, switching to you, Ellie, you know, you, the oldest of
yes.
six.
Yes.
And, I mean, you didn't have a choice in all this, which is, you're just yeah. thrown into it. Tell us some of the things that maybe they didn't just teach you, your parents, but maybe that you caught along the way,
yeah.
you know, that you're living in, you know, right now. It's kind of become who you
yeah,
are.
Yeah, totally. Looking back on that season. Only now do I realize how crazy and how not everyone gets to experience that. I was in, you know, at school, coming back from like a month tour and trying to explain to like my 8-year-old friends at school, like what's just happened. And they were like, don't get what you're talking about. But I think I count that as such a, I don't know, I'm just so grateful for those delirious days and traveling with all my cousins and my siblings, and feel like we're having like night after night sleepovers on the tour bus and running around at soundcheck. But I think something that I'll always be so grateful for is being in the room from such a young age in the presence of God with people singing about Jesus and not being scared of the Holy Spirit and seeing what he does, and people getting healed left, right, and center, and people getting free of stuff. And I think that's something that I'm so grateful that my family like exposed us to, I guess, all different churches and venues and gigs, and it never gets boring too. There's always something else God's doing, and I just see, I don't know, I want to bring that. I don't want to ever be scared of what the Holy Spirit can do. And so I want to keep that and keep exposing my own children. Yeah.
Amazing.
In years come to come. On. I don't have any children.
Yeah, come on. Yeah, we were laughing backstage because Vinny's daughters said, hey, is there any chance we can get to meet Ellie behind stage? And they don't know anything about Martin. So, which is just, it's just so cool. So, Ellie has some incredible material out there. She's just come out with a new album. And so, just, you know, not to make it a plug, but maybe just talk about the message behind this new record, these songs that you're writing or releasing right now.
Yes. So, I totally wasn't planning on doing my own music thing and blah, blah, blah. But I always loved singing, always loved leading worship at church and at youth group. And, always loved photography too, so I was definitely going down the photography route. But it was only maybe a year and a half ago where God totally spoke into my heart about doing my own thing, writing my own songs, and felt I was injected almost with a vision and a dream to write for this next generation. So these 6 songs on my EP, it's really just a collation of songs about hope, joy, freedom. I love to dance, so there's definitely some songs where you can turn up loud and go wild around your kitchen or in your car. But these songs are just, yeah, my expression, I guess. And the awe and wonder of God, it's all about that.
Come on, everything's available out in the lobby. Yeah, come on, it's amazing. Spotify, Apple, check it out, it's incredible. And now you're singing with your dad, and I have 2 daughters, so I selfishly am like, one of you is gonna be a worship leader, because that is like bucket list, like leading worship with my daughter. Come on, it's amazing. And, but Martin, traveling with you a couple times, seeing you out on the road, we were actually randomly in Singapore together. Yeah. With Randy and Bill, and, you know, just seeing you travel with your family, now leading with your daughter, you know, it's such a beautiful picture of generations running together, and that's a huge thing on this house. We're actually in that season right now, right? And, you know, I think, you know, once a pioneer, always a pioneer. You pioneered something with Delirious, but obviously with your new songs, with this new record, even what you touched on in worship today, you're always leaning in for the next thing. What's God doing with this generation and the next generation? So if you don't mind, maybe share a little bit about what you're seeing, you know, on the church level globally, from a creative standpoint, from a worship standpoint, or really just the message that you're carrying right now for the church.
Wow. Let me think of something. Well, I think the more you sort of go on in life and you become aware of your own sort of frailties and weaknesses, but you realize how amazing church is, don't you? This thing that we do, I can say it sort of saves my life, because if I was left to my own devices, I'd be in all sorts of trouble. But because I have friends and family and this church thing and we worship together, that really, like, it makes up for all of our small inadequacies, doesn't it? And so I love the idea of church. It's God's greatest idea. And of course, you bring your kids up in it. So I would say at all costs, just look after the family vision, because it doesn't matter what great grand ideas you have, what courses you start, what, you know, buildings you build, or what, it all comes back eventually to the same thing, that we need to look after each other and look after people that are here, and be passionate about that. And you know, the family thing is so sort of attacked from all sides now, isn't it? So we should preserve that and be proud of that. The other thing, obviously, as someone who's creative, I do feel passionately about that, the sort of creative tribe in church. And I would perhaps represent that a little bit. And this whole idea that our lives are holistic, aren't they? That God doesn't look at our life and think, oh, well, that's the bit you do on Sunday, and then that's the bit you do at work, or that's the bit you do on vacation, or, you know, we're all one person, and actually, the more we can be one soul and one spirit and body, the more whole we become anyway. So I just want to encourage you, you know, like the gifts that God's given you, have the faith to believe that they're not just for Sunday morning, but that it is for your community, it's for midweek, it's when you're at school and you're teaching, it's when you are nursing, it's when you're DJing, it's you're out there, and just let the fire of God that's in you be, just set it on fire. And I'm trying to explain this. I have three versions of me, really. Like, one version of me is, I love this, like, this is a sweet spot in the house, leading worship. And then another version is, we'll go and do big sort of worship concerts, maybe in a neutral venue, a theatre or a club or something, you know, with sticky floors, you know, that sort of thing. You know exactly what I mean. And then another thing is, some of the same guys, we've got a band called Army of Bones, and we go into tiny little clubs and just play rock and roll. They wouldn't know we're Christians, and it's more like a mainstream vibe. We play a whole different set of songs, but it's still me. And I'm still there asking for the fire to fall. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, God's not looking at it going, oh, that's your church bit, that's your bit in the middle, and then that's the bit you do. I feel like God's smiling on all of it and saying, great, I never said to you that you could only do one thing.
Wow.
You can do all these things. And I can write a country song if I want to. Not probably very badly, but you know what I'm saying? So I think God wants to expand us all.
Yeah.
And the more we sort of live a full life, the more fulfilling that is, really.
I just feel, come on, anybody else feel the presence of the Lord on that? I just feel like there's an opportunity this morning. Yeah, come on. I just feel like there's an opportunity for an impartation here this morning. This message is for every single person in every single seat. So, you know, if any of that pertains to you, if you want to be ignited this morning, right where you are, your own sphere of influence, no matter what your job, no matter what your background, God can use you right where you are. I don't know, I just feel like we should have everybody stand.
Yeah.
And then, Martin, if you don't mind, to pray, and maybe we'll have the band come back, and just, this isn't the end, this is just, I don't know, I don't want to miss an opportunity. So does that make sense? So however you feel comfortable, you know, if you want to get out of your seats, if you want to come forward, if you're feeling God draw you here in this place, or lift your hands, or get on your knees, whatever it is, let's just do that. Father, we welcome your presence. We thank you for all that you've done this morning and what you're going to continue to do right now. Father, we come with expectation that we can be changed in a moment, that we can be filled in a moment, we can be ignited in a moment. Amen.
Holy Spirit, come upon us today. Thank you. just all the people here today, you know that God is with you. You feel the Spirit of God upon your life, but sometimes you feel like you don't really fit in. You know, what can I really bring? But can you just lift your hands? Would that be okay? You know, what you bring is a little bit abstract, maybe, or nobody knows who you are or notices, but Father God, he really does see everything. And the way he made you to be is the way he made you to be. And he didn't mess up in that respect. And so just give it to God today. And God's, he's so kind, he's just gonna bless you today.
Find me at your
Not just being like church, but the family of God. But I'd like to almost sort of prophesy to you that this is not just a family of God, but you're the army of God in this region. There's something fierce about you. You want the presence of God. And I love that passage in Ezekiel 37 about the dry bones. And I'd love to read that over you. In fact, actually, I'm not going to read it. I'm going to sing it over you, if that's okay. We're going to kind of do a ministry time, but with a different vibe. But I want to speak into life the bones coming alive and the army coming alive, and that you're not just individuals doing your own thing, but this is incredible. And the army comes out of brokenness, doesn't it? And we rise up and we sing our songs beyond the buildings into people's lives.
Everybody is broken. Everybody is broken. Everybody is broken. Everybody is broken. and everybody breaks, but the bones will rise again. God grabbed me, God's spirit took me up and set me down in the middle of an open plain strewn with bombs. He led me around and among them, dry bones, bleached by the sun. He said to me, son of man, can these bones live? And I said, can't you see? Everybody is broken. Everybody is broken. Everybody is broken. Everybody is broken. And everybody breaks. But the bones will walk again. God the Master told the dry bones, watch this, I'm bringing the breath of life to you and you'll come to life. As I prophesied, there was a sound and all a rustling. The bones moved and came together, bone to bone again. Watching the muscles, then sinews form, then skin stretched over them, but they had no breath. They still had no breath. 'Cause everybody is broken. Everybody is broken. Everybody is broken. Everybody is broken. And everybody breaks. But the bones will speak again. Everybody is broken. Everybody is broken. Everybody is broken. Everybody is broken. And everybody breaks. But the bones will live again. You put the pieces back together, together. You put the pieces back together. Anybody know how that feels? Ellie, come on.
We will dance together.
together. Yeah, we will dance together. Hey, we're gonna dance together. I'm coming back to the star where you found me. I'm coming back to your heart. Now I surrender. Take me. This is all I can bring.
All right, come on. One, two.
You'll never stop loving. Okay, we're going to finish in a minute, but we're going to do one last thing. Can you put your arms around someone? Come on, just put them around someone like me and Johnny. That's right. Don't leave anybody out. If you're on the back and you're thinking, this is my worst nightmare, it's too late. We've locked the doors. All right. We're just going to... I feel alive. I come alive. I am alive.
Somebody's shoulder. God, thank you for what you're doing in this house this morning. Come on, man. There's liberty. So many people are experiencing liberty you haven't experienced in years. Come on. God's breaking off stuff. Come on. Inhibitions are just falling to the ground, God. God, we thank you for all the activity of the Holy Spirit, God. Come on. This is unlike any Sunday we've ever had before. God, we thank you. Where your spirit is, there's great freedom, God. We thank you for the freedom we are experiencing here, God. God, let us walk it out. Carry this freedom wherever we go all week long, God. God, thank you for your presence in our lives. Come on, man. Come on. I just felt people being unleashed this morning, unleashed to be who God's called you to be. Come on. Not holding back anymore. Come on. Not afraid, unashamed. Come on. Going after all the things God's put in your heart. Amen? Come on. Can we give the Lord one big more shout? Come on. Yeah. Yeah. Woo. Yeah. All right. Church, can we say thank you to Martin and the whole team here? Come on, man. Thank you, guys. Thank you. So good, man. All right. Well, love on some people around you. Buy everything that he's bought so he didn't have to take anything back with him. Does that sound good? Come on. Go out there and buy all the product you can. Love on each other. Have a great week. Be blessed to have a good week.